In the meantime, next week is my last week before then, and I'm telling you what, I'm putting in work right now. Some serious properties are being moved by me right now. I'm listing a lot of stuff. I'm selling a lot of stuff. I'm just taking care of business. Everything is falling into place. I feel like I'm in the zone. But somebody type in a topic that you guys want to talk about today. I'm sorry that we had technical difficulties, but we will have Daniel back on the show next week. And we'll get that taken care of so that he can share. Because this guy, Daniel, absolutely is the best social media real estate guy that I've seen. I have done a lot of research. I've looked at a lot of different agents. And this guy just has it down pat because he does a lot of stuff organically. And he just knows how to do certain things. He uses several different platforms, not just the ones that you're thinking of, other ones as well, that he utilizes. And he utilizes them very well. So I'm super excited about having him on and just explaining his philosophy around social media. And he's actually going to share 3 to 5 of the most recent breakthroughs he's had or tips for you as far as social media goes. So I'm actually excited about it myself. I'm going to take a bunch of notes and I'm hoping to learn something as well. So somebody give me a question or a topic to talk about. And I'm just going to rant on for this episode. Let's see, we got Pettigay is here. She says, what's your thoughts on going live at property showing in regards to client privacy? I don't do that myself. I don't go live when I'm showing properties. I thought about it a couple times. I should go live right now. It's really cool. And if you want to, if you feel like you want to, ask the client. It doesn't hurt to say, hey, do you mind if I go live real quick and show this property and stuff? Or do you mind if I have you on my live or something like that? Ask them if they're okay and comfortable with it, if you feel like they might be, and then do it that way. But I don't do it just because I don't want to freak my client out. I want there to be zero reason for my client to feel uncomfortable for any reason at any time. That's why you'll see in the daily grind shows, we don't show a lot of the actual clients and showing the properties and writing the contracts and negotiating. You know, we don't show a lot of that stuff just because we don't want my clients to feel any kind of uncomfortability whatsoever. So just be careful with it. If you see a property while you're showing and you like it, make a note and go back to it once, you're done showing, go back to it and go live with nobody there and just talk about how awesome it is. Betty, what's up, Betty? She says, hey, Ricky, I have a seller I'm meeting with next week that I met prospecting. I invited him and his wife to lunch next week. How do you recommend the luncheon goes? I wonder if you're asking me, like, if you want me to kind of guess how it's going to go and they're going to love you and use you as a realtor for life, or if you're wondering, specify your question, Betty. I would love to know what you're asking me there exactly, so that I could fully answer it the correct way. Let's see. Lauren Pippin Anderson, who is, by the way, our front desk girl here at RE/MAX of Orange Beach, is asking me, is there ever, in quotes, a time when you completely stop real estate at personal time? Oh, absolutely. Every day. It's 4 o'clock right now. It's 4:15 where I'm at. I'll be done with this show at 5. I'll probably take some notes and do something for about 30 minutes, and that's it. At that point, then I'm either going to decide if it's going to be a chill night or if maybe I'm going to write a blog or work on a video or something. But whatever I do in my after hours is what I want to do. You know, that's my personal time. You know, I do what I want to do all day long. You have to love everything you do. Life's too short. Do what you love to do constantly. But, you know, I do, and I built this huge real estate business. So you know, during the day, I have to maintain the real estate business. But in the evening times after 5 or 6 o'clock, that's my time. So I'm either going to write a blog or chill. And definitely on the weekends. Weekends are my time. Now, if I'm a new agent and I'm trying to build my business, I don't have any me time. Everything goes into building my business until I get it where I need to be. The only reason I can take weekends now is because I'm where I'm at. Now, when I say take weekends, if somebody wants to see a property or have a listing appointment, I'm there all day. I'll work Saturday or Sunday. It doesn't matter. I'll meet anybody, anytime, anywhere. And on the weekends, I am doing a lot of writing, videos, posting and stuff of that nature, plotting and scheming. I know exactly how I'm going to take everything to the next level. But guys, you don't realize this, but I take a lot of time for myself. I want you guys to understand that. I take a lot of time for myself. So don't get it confused. Don't think that my job rules me. And I have complete control over my work, and I have great balance between my work and my personal life. I work out every day. I try to maintain health, wealth, happiness, and love. Health, wealth, love, and happiness. Those are the four most important things to keep major balance, and I understand that. So I do the very best I can do every day to maintain that. Pedagay says, thanks. I don't either, but in my area, I'm noticing a lot of clothes. I'm noticing or showing lots of closings. I'll take your tip to return later. Oh, okay. Yeah. I mean, you can do it with the client if you want to, but I don't want to do anything that makes them feel uncomfortable. All right. Betty says, what should I discuss? Oh, okay. What should you discuss at your lunch meeting, or should it be just about creating a relationship and no real estate discussed? I like the latter part of that. Not very much real estate unless they bring it up. You know, there's a fine line there, Betty, and you just have to fill it out. Everybody's different. Some people just want to get right to the point. Right. It's just like I say about making phone calls. When you're making phone calls, you have to get really good at molding into who you're talking to. I'm not saying, try to mirror them. I'm saying fit with them like a puzzle piece and give them what they need to feel comfortable with you. So if they want to talk real estate, talk real estate. But I wouldn't bring it up unless they bring it up, or if you feel like that's what they want to talk about. I would definitely bring comps with me. You know, I always want to bring the comps. That way, if we do want to talk about it, I have it right there. But it's going to be in a folder, and I'm not going to open it up unless they want me to. And then if we never talk about real estate, at the end of the meal, I'm going to give them the folder, say, here's the comps. You know, I was going to bring this for you and leave it with you. So it's a feel thing. But go into it thinking you're not going to talk about real estate until it comes up. Let's see. John Krause, how are you doing, big guy? I hope everything's well with you, man. He says, what are your thoughts on brokerage pushing paid training on their agents? Well, John, it depends on the training, right? I think that some of it's good and some of it's not. I think that some of them are going overboard with how much training they're doing, and they're taking away time that you need to build your business. You know, you can't just sit around training all the time and not take action. You need a little training, the most successful people, you can show them something once or at the most twice and they got it. They don't need to see something over and over and over again. The people that go to these trainings over and over and over and over again, that's all they're ever going to do is just go to these trainings forever. They're never going to take enough action because they're too busy going to trainings, trying to learn what to do. And they're using it as a crutch, as an excuse not to take action because they're still trying to learn, even though they're learning the same thing over and over and over again. So I think my thoughts are that I'm kind of mixed about it because everybody needs training. And then there's good and bad training. I think that if I'm a new agent, I think the name of the game is for sale by owners and expires for the first month. Get your feet wet, get as much experience as you can, realize that that's not the way to go, and that's not going to get you where you want to be, but you got a lot of experience out of it. And then switch to circle prospecting and do that until you're making $1 million a year. It's really as simple as that. It's a lot more complicated as far as the details of how to put it all together, but that's really the name of the game. You can do the internet lead thing. Daniel does very well with that, but he does it a different way. He doesn't buy leads from Zillow. I'm pretty sure he doesn't buy leads. I think he gets leads organically through you know, Instagram and all the different, you know, platforms and channels that he works. I mean, he has like 20,000 Instagram followers. You know, the dude is a beast. So, to answer your question, I would have to see the training. I would have to know which company, and I would have to see how much training is involved to really answer your question. But I think the main thing is once you learn what works, what do you need training for anymore? You know, take action. And then, you know, once you take enough action with what you learned and you feel like you hit a plateau, that's when you need more training to get to the next level. Right. But it has to be a train and then work, work, work until you plateau, and then train and then go to the next level and then work, work, work till you plateau. So I think that's the best formula. Zach says, hey, Ricky, I noticed in your 90-day action plan that you say to mail the farm area, then call exactly a week after sending the mailers. What's your idea behind that? Does it really matter? No, it doesn't matter. That's part of the action plan. Hey, what's up, Justin? Give me a question, Justin. That's just in the action plan to kind of give you just something to go by. Because a lot of people, they feel better if they know that the owner has received their postcard or letter or whatever before they call. But the phone script's not going to change at all. The phone script is the same whether you call them before they get the postcard, after, or if you never even sent them a postcard, right? And so that's the thing, too, people don't get. Once you've called everyone that you send mail to, you keep calling people. Like, you keep calling neighborhoods that you've never sent mail to. So there's no real idea behind that, Zach. Just crush it. Let's see. Phil Owens. How you doing, Phil? Phil says, or did you hear what happened?
Oh, yeah.
Daniel's thing messed up. Yeah. Let's see. Phil Owen says, I'm getting ready to start circle prospecting. Any tips? Well, I built a 7-figure real estate business around circle prospecting only. It takes a long time. You have to be super patient. You have to call thousands of people. You're not going to get anything. You know, you might, if you call 100 people a day, you might get one deal a week, which is good, right? That's what people don't get. They'll call 100 or 200 or 300 people and not get a deal, and then they quit. But the base of it is to have dual purpose, right? You're calling 1,000 people to try to make a deal happen, but if the deal doesn't happen, then you've created, you know, maybe 30, 40 relationships for the future out of those calls. So you didn't lose, right? You didn't get a deal out of it, but you created relationships for the future. Now the second 1,000 people you call, you may get 2 deals out of it and 30 people for the future. And so circle prospecting, you're building your business for the future. You're building a huge business for the future, but you're also going to crush it in the short term if you do it. If you put the hours in you need to actually succeed. But I'll tell you, it is the most efficient way, in my mind, to build a huge business for long term and then to have residual referrals and past clients coming back to you. And even people that never bought from you will kind of be considered as a past client, because it's somebody you talk to and then 7 years later they come back to you to buy something or sell something. It's an amazing program that I put together. It's exactly how I built my business, and it works. I've been coaching now for maybe 6-7 months, and we're almost to 100 agents in the coaching program, and we're seeing huge success. And these things take time, but huge success. Justin says, knowing what you know now, what are two things you would tell your younger self if you were in your first year of real estate? Well, the first thing I would say, if I were talking to Ricky back in 2002 when he first started real estate, the first thing I would say is as far as the work ethic side, keep doing what you're doing, and have faith that you're going to make it, right? If you work hard and continue doing what you're doing. You know, going from roofing to selling real estate, you know, I'm just a hardworking guy. So I would say never lose the work ethic. Continue working harder and harder and harder. The second thing is that I would tell myself is that when a prospect tells you no, it doesn't mean no. It just means not right now, but maybe later. Thanks for asking. Please stay in touch with me. Too many people get hung up on no's, and too many people get hung up when a deal doesn't work out or a deal falls through. You know, that seems to crush a lot of you. And, you know, it just doesn't crush me. I don't worry about deals that fall through. Because I'm not looking at the bottom line. I'm not looking at the results. I don't count my commission checks. You know, I'm not thinking, oh, I have 50,000 in commissions under contract, and then if it falls through, I only have 40,000. You know, I don't look at that. I just work and try to do everything I can do to make every deal work out. And if it doesn't work out, then I know I did all I could do to make it work out. But when it falls through, I learn something and I have future time back that I can go get 5 more deals. So, keep working hard. And when somebody tells you no, it doesn't mean no. It just means not right now, but maybe later. I could think of other things too, Justin, that I might tell my younger self, but those are the first two that come to mind. Zach says, I haven't dived into the sphere of influence scripts yet, but how do you deal with sphere of influence without coming off too phony? Listen, Zach, you don't call your sphere of influence, you know, you don't come off too phony if you're not being phony, right? So just call them and be real and genuine with them, and that won't be phony. If you're not phony, then it's not going to come off to be phony. If you feel like it's phony, then they're going to feel like it's phony because they can hear in your voice that you feel like it's phony, right? So when you call up a sphere of influence, you're just going to say, hey, you know, how you doing? You know, look, I don't know if you knew I was in real estate or not, but is there anything I can do for you? Okay, cool. You know, keep me in mind. Let me know if there's something I could do for you. I'll stay in touch with you. And be real. Don't try to do a deal. Call him to see what you can do to help him. You're a real estate agent. You're meant to help people. So see what you can do to help them. You know, it's like I had a closing today, and I was at the closing table, and she was saying, you know, I need to get in real estate as much as you're selling. And I said, yeah, I'm selling a lot, but it took me a long time to get here, and it took me a lot of work to get here. And I said, you know, I get excited about the fact of me helping people. You know, that's the whole name of the game. It's like helping people. And I said, it's like you, ma'am. You wanted to sell your condo so that you could buy a house. It wasn't about the deal or about the money. It was about helping you sell the condo because you wanted to do something else. And that was something you had in your life plan to go from that condo to a house. And I felt obligated to help her do that. You know, the money's just the perk. That's just the cherry on top. That's what you have to have to live, and you got to have money and money, money, money. But money comes from helping people. The people that go after transactions, not relationships, they don't make as much money. They just don't make as much money. They have the wrong mindset. And, you know, they just, I don't know. I blow right past those guys. I'm not worried about them. Let's see. Zach says, I guess I feel phony to me. It feels phony to me because I have the thought of real estate in the back of my mind. Right on, man. Quit thinking about real estate. When you're calling your sphere of influence or anybody, right? This goes for anybody you call. You're not going to think about real estate. You're not trying to do a deal. You're just trying to see what you can do to help them. Do they want to sell their house because they want to upgrade? Do they want to buy something because their kid went to college? Do you know they have to sell a house because their mom died? Did they have a third baby and they need an extra bedroom and want to sell and upgrade to a bigger house? You know, it's not about the house. It's not about the deal. It's about them needing something, and it's your job to help them do it. And helping them may be to not do anything at all right now. It may be that they just aren't ready to do anything. They're comfortable where they are. Maybe later, right? That's fine. You're here to help them if they want to do something, and you're here to stay in touch with them if they don't. It's not rocket science. Cassie, how are you? She says, what would you tell a new agent in her first year that's struggling to make it to a closing, get a new client, and get in all the first out of the way so you can have that experience to be able to get more clients without having to say that you haven't had any prior closings? Well, there's a lot to that, Cassie. There really is a lot to that. I would say the first thing is don't tell anybody you're a new agent. And don't tell anybody you haven't done any closings, right? Secondly, it's all about personality and feeling confident with yourself. When you're with people, if you feel confident and you feel comfortable in the situation, they are going to feel comfortable with you. That's the main thing. They don't care how many properties you sold. They don't care how many clients you have or haven't had. They don't care about any of that stuff. All they care about is that you're going to work hard and take care of them, and that they feel comfortable with you. So quit focusing on, you're focusing on the wrong things. You're focusing on, oh, I haven't sold anything, so I don't have any ammunition to use to get people to like me as an agent because I sold something. That's not what you need is ammunition. What you need is confidence, and you need to feel comfortable with other people so they feel comfortable with you, and then they're going to use you. That's all there is to it. Now, that's that side of it. The other side of it is you're probably, I can tell by your question, you're probably not talking to enough people, right? You're probably just not talking to enough people. You're probably scared to talk to people because you're uncomfortable. And then when you're uncomfortable, they feel uncomfortable. You know, the list goes on and on. You need to feel confident. You need to feel comfortable. And you need to talk to hundreds of people every week and find the people that like you and start working with them. And don't try to make a deal happen. Find out what you can do to help them, whether it be to help them next year, 5 years down the road, or today. You're gonna run it, you know, as a realtor, your job is to talk to as many people as you can, and then if they need help today, help them. If they need help tomorrow, help them. If they need help next week, next month, next year, 10 years from now, that's how you do it. You stay in touch with them forever, but you're going to run into people that want help now. You're going to run into people that want to help later, but it's all around helping people, not doing deals. So have confidence and talk to more people. Let's see. Justin says, in your opinion, has your success became possible due to your work ethic or hustle? Is there another characteristic that played a big role in your success? It's a little bit of both. I'm very quick learner. Like if somebody teaches me something, I only need to listen to it or see it one time, and that's it. And I got it. And the same thing when I make mistakes. If I make a mistake, and I don't make that mistake again. Now, it could be a mistake that I just need to, when you fail, you keep trying. It may be something that I need to keep trying at, but since I failed that one time, I learned something out of it. I'm just so good at learning from my mistakes and then, watching something once and learning from it. I'm a really quick learner. So being a really quick learner and then having this huge work ethic behind me and huge drive, that's been big. So, I've always been really decent in math. I've always been good at putting stuff together. So I can visualize things very well. So I think that, like I said, a really, really, strong work ethic plus being a quick learner, And so when I read books, it's like I learn so much because I'm such a quick learner. I get everything out of it. When I watch YouTube videos of successful people, it absorbs into my brain and just becomes part of me. So I'm just always getting better, and I'll never quit getting better. I'm looking for the next level all the time. That's another part of success. You never rest on your laurels. There's like always another level. There's always somebody that's better than you that you can learn from. I hit this guy up, Jordan Cohen, out in California. He was the number one Remax agent last year in the USA, did $165 million in sales. And I hit him up on Instagram, and he messaged me back, and we're going to talk on the phone next week. Here the number one agent in the country, and I'm chasing him. I want to talk to him. I want to exchange stories. I want to create a relationship with him because I'm trying to go to the next level always. There's always somebody to learn from. There's always something new to learn. So I think real estate is a lot of stages and phases. And everybody goes through the same phases in real estate. And I think that some people just get stuck in the first couple phases. And then some people are always going to the next phase. So don't get stuck. Don't rest on your laurels. Don't think that you got it all figured out. Continue learning, continue growing. Sharon Powell, how are you? She says, I circle prospected yesterday around a listing near my house. It felt good to talk about the property, not try to sell them. Exactly. You call people, you tell them what's going on with the market and say, hey, is there anything I can do for you? I mean, people, there's a lot of high pressure sales stuff out there. Coaches and people and programs that want you to call for sale by owners and expireds and high pressure sell them, go after the deal. I'm speaking from experience. It's all about helping people and growing relationships and then having a system in place to stay in touch with them forever. Zach says, I totally agree. Got to change the defensive mindset, like I'm bothering people, and really learn that low pressure approach of helping people. Got to stay conspicuously aware, constantly work at it. Yeah, man. It's all about changing your mindset. That's my whole goal with you guys. My entire goal with you is to flip your mindset from this, got to make a deal happen, to I got to help people. You know, it's very rewarding. It makes you feel so good when you're helping people, but it's much more profitable too. You get the best of both worlds. You get to help people on a large scale, and you make more money. It's a win-win. I like to do everything with dual purpose. So, you know, my dual purpose is to help people and make money, right? And I'm making the money so that I can in turn help more people, like you guys. You guys wouldn't believe how much money I've spent on my coaching business to help you guys. It's crazy. But I know that it's going to help so many people, and there's nothing out there like it. It's the best way to build a huge business and to survive a market crash. So I'm going to continue doing it. At some point, it'll be profitable, but I put a lot of money into it. So, you know, I make money, and then you take the money and you help people. Justin says, what's your long-term vision for your business or life? Legacy, Justin. I want to be known when I die as someone who did everything he could to make the world a better place. To, you know, I want to be responsible for lowering the failure rate in the real estate industry. I want to be known for the guy that would do anything for you. I want to be known for the guy that was so busy, but yet he answered every email I sent him. He answered every phone call that I called him. He answered every email. You know, I want to be known for the guy that's not about the money. So to me, it's legacy, right? But I know what you're asking. You're asking like where, you know, where my business is going and stuff like that. Who knows where we'll go? See, I don't like to create goals around results, because when you do that, I think you need to do that in the beginning. Because you need, if you have zero listings, you need 10 listings right now. You know, if you have zero sales, you need to do 10 sales this year, 20 sales this year. So you need goals. I'm not saying that, but I've quit making results goals ever since I got to where I'm making enough to live on. Everything else is all about how hard I'm going to work. So my goals are focused around my daily actions, not how much money I'm going to make. So where do I see my life and my business from this point? I'll tell you exactly what I feel like would be like the best for me, right? The best for me would be where I coach and I sell real estate till the day I die. I mean, that would be like my dream. If I could run this coaching business the way I'm doing it, and maintain the real estate business the way that I'm doing that, until the day I die. You know, I'm going to Kansas City in the end of October to do a speech. I'm going to end up traveling all over the country over the next 12 months doing speeches for real estate agents. So I'm going to be doing a lot of traveling, but you know, my real estate bit, this year's been so interesting how I've been able to maintain my real estate business while launching this coaching business. I've maintained it so well. It's incredible. And I really don't, you know, it's amazing to me. So at the beginning, when I first launched my real estate business, my coaching business, there was about maybe 3 months where I was stressed out a lot. I was stressed out because I was spending half of my time on a business other than real estate. You know, real estate, I'm going to do 7 figures this year. I'll cross 7 figures next month for the year. And just as a single agent, not a team. I mean, me and my dad are already way over $1 million as a team. I don't talk team stats. Bruce. Bruce says, coming to Chicago. So let us all know when I'm coming to Chicago, Bruce. Because I'm ready to roll up there, man. So back to what I was saying, what was I saying? Oh, I was very stressed out about spending so much time, and I was worried. I was super worried that I was going to take time away from real estate and that it was going to hurt me. I just kept on grinding. I kept on working, and now I'm in a groove. Now I'm in my zone. Now everything's running super smooth, and I don't have that worry anymore. I don't have that stress because now I've done it, and I know that I can maintain my real estate business. And, I didn't have any closings for October as of maybe 2 or 3 weeks ago. Now I have like 6 closings or 7. I have to go and look, but it's a lot. When I didn't have any for a while, I had 12 for September, so it wasn't like I was hurting, but I had 0 for October. But I didn't stress out. I just kept doing what I'm doing. I know it'll come if I put the work in, and that's experience talking. When you maintain composure, when you don't have deals going on, you maintain composure when the market starts to crash, or in the wintertime when it gets slow. If you maintain composure through the downs and you continue working hard, that's where you've reached the next level. So think about that for a second. When you guys are running through your business, you have a bunch of closings 1 month and then none the next month, you kind of get down on yourself. I've been there so many times. And what I've learned is that there's no reason to be down. No reason to worry. Just keep working at it. Deals are going to come. Transactions are happening every single day. So just keep at it. Justin says, are you okay with making an 8-figure salary so we can provide more opportunities and give more value to as many people as you can? Keep crushing it, brother. You're on the right track, no doubt. It will grow like you can't even believe. That's our biggest problem. We don't really know our own potential. True, man. I have no idea what my potential is. I mean, I know it's like crazy, but I think it's way crazier than I think. I'm doing the YouTube show, The Daily Grind, where it's a reality show of my life. Episode number 20 just dropped today. 21's done, dropping Saturday. We filmed, I think, 24 today. They're getting better and better and better every time, but I only have 250 YouTube subscribers, right? Nothing happens overnight. This stuff is just not going to explode right in front of your face. You just have to stay at it. I'm trying to grow my Instagram account. I'm at like 1,300. There's people with millions and tens of thousands and even like 5,000. That's a lot to me right now. So, but I just started social media this year. Last year, up until January this year, I never touched social media whatsoever. So I think as far as I've come in, since January, I think we'll look back in the year and say, wow, Ricky has really figured a lot of stuff out, and it didn't take him long to get there. So I'm now looking at the next frontier. I'm trying to get ahead of the curve because I've been so behind the curve on everything. I'm trying to get ahead of the curve now. So it's taking me a second to catch up, but I'm going to get there. But absolutely, man, people underestimate what they can do in the long term and overestimate what they can do in the short term. It's like everybody wants to sell 100 properties this year, and they start getting down on themselves when they can't sell 100 properties this year, but they don't realize that 20 or 30 they sold this year is great. And that they keep it up, they will get to 100 and farther in the next 3 or 4 or 5 years, if they continue doing what they know works and working hard and trying to help people and focusing around relationships, not transactions. So, I'm excited about the future. I'm so glad that you guys, are enjoying the journey, watching me go on this journey. It's a lot of fun. It's a lot of pressure. It's taken a lot away from other things. But I love it. I love the pressure. I love the challenge. I'm very competitive. and I love challenges. And I feel like when I look at the failure rate in the real estate industry, 80%, it makes me want to step up. I can't go to sleep at night knowing that I could be helping you guys if I'm not helping you guys. If I didn't do these live videos and do the group and do the coaching and stuff, there's no way I could sleep at night. I would go insane knowing that all the knowledge I have up here can help you guys so much, and I'm just keeping it all to myself. So anyway, let me know if you guys have any more questions. That's pretty much all I got for today. I'm sorry that the Daniel Wilson thing didn't work out the way I wanted to, but I promise you we'll figure out what the technical difficulties are and get him back on next week, because the guy has some serious knowledge he's going to drop. It's going to be super cool. So let me know if you guys have any more questions before I go. And, we'll just we'll call it a day and go to the next day, because, I'm grinding. Absolutely grinding. I have a notebook all ready to take some notes for Daniel. The guy knows some serious stuff. Well, I'll tell you this, guys. It's been a real pleasure. I'm going to give it another maybe 30 seconds to see if you guys have any further questions. I really appreciate you guys. Always, always reach out to me and let me know if there's anything I can do for you. I'm always here for you. I'll always answer your email. I'll always answer your phone call, your text message. However you try to communicate with me, I'll always get back to you. Unless for some reason I didn't see it, that's the only reason I wouldn't get back to you, which that can happen. So if that does happen, try to contact me a different way, because it's not me ignoring you. It's maybe because I didn't see it. Well, it didn't turn out like we wanted to, but I think we had a good show, answered a lot of good questions, and had a lot of good content. So I guess that's it, guys. We'll talk to you soon. Y'all be good, and let me know what I can do for you.